Welcome as we gather at the end of this day that God has made. It began with the fog of this morning and then the sun and warmth. And as we prepare for the stars to come out tonight, a beautiful day of rest where we can step back from the rhythm of our normal day and experience God's gift even today of his eternal Sabbath. To do that tonight, just a reminder of the weekend to remember I announced this morning. If you're a married couple and you would like to invest in your marriage, again, please let me know sometime in this coming week if you'd like us to register for you for that in the coming months. With that before us, let's just quiet our hearts and ask for God's blessing on our lives, our families, and our time of worship together. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God who calls us to know you and who enables us to know you through your revelation and creation, the beauty of leaves that will change soon, the fields of corn and soybeans that surround us and remind us of your provision, the wonder of sunrises and sunsets, Lord, in all these things you reveal your power, your glory, your creativity. Lord, we thank you also that you invite us to know you through your word. And you gather this community of brothers and sisters to gather each Sunday around your word to learn about you, to encounter you through your spirit, and then to be agents of you in this world that you're redeeming. And Father, we thank you for each person here and those listening by radio or television or internet. Lord, we thank you that we are not alone in this world, but that we belong body and soul to a faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And in belonging to him, are united to one another. So, Father, receive our worship, speak to us, move among us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, would you please stand for our call to worship? I mentioned this morning the wonder of worship is not simply engaging concepts about God, but recognizing the presence of God with us. We begin our service today with the closing words of Psalm 46 that remind us of that promise. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. The wonder of worship is we worship a God who is with us. Let's sing those words, number 244 in our gray books. God himself is with us, stanza 1-3. God who is with us is a God who brings his greeting tonight. to those who have been called, who are beloved by God the Father and kept safe in Jesus Christ. Grace, mercy, and love be to each of you now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, if you're able, let's take a few moments and greet those around us, especially any who are guests tonight with us. Friends, this morning we lifted high the name of Jesus. We hailed the power of Jesus' name, and tonight we finish this day blessing the name of our Lord. Let's sing together. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And you may be seated. A call to worship began with the invitation to be still and know that I am God. We respond to that in our next song, Be Still, My Soul, in You I Rest.
To order and provide. God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Thy hope, thy confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul, the waves and winds still know his voice who ruled them while he dwelt below. In you I rest, in you I found my hope, in you I trust. You within your hands alone. Be still, my soul. Still, my soul. The hour is hastening on when we shall be forever with the Lord. When joy is restored. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past. All safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. In you I rest, in you I found my hope, in you I trust.
In that holy stillness, we turn to God's word. Before we do, I'd like to invite any children up for a children's message this evening. So any boys and girls, if you're a visitor even with us, you're welcome to come up for our children's message. Come on up. I see a couple in the back. Hey, come on up. Yeah. Daddy can come up if he needs to. No. All right. No, it's great to see you all here tonight. We're not going to talk about what we did this morning. This morning, remember, we used those two words, expiation and propitiation. You can ask your parents what those mean because they learned that this morning. But tonight, I just want to play a game with you. It's a game that my wife and I play a lot at our house. Has anyone ever played the game Simon Says? Right? So when you say Simon Says, you have to do it. And when you don't say Simon Says, you don't do it, right? In the parsonage, though, we call that Anna Says. So we're going to play Anna Says tonight. So, all right, Anna Says, touch your nose. Anna Says, pat your head. Anna Says, rub your belly. Clap two times. Anna didn't say. Remember, Anna has to say. Anna says, give someone a high five. Anna says, give someone a low five. Stump your feet. No, Anna didn't say. You gotta get, this is important. It's a silly game, but what we're talking about tonight is the third petition of the Lord's Prayer. And that's, we say, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. And what's the third thing we say? Your will be done. And what we're really praying there is we're really asking God, we want to play Simon Says, or we want to hear what you want us to do, and we want to do your will. So whenever you pray that prayer and you get to the third petition, I want you to think, that's saying to God, whatever you say, I'm going to do. And what you don't say, I won't do. Just like Simon says, but whatever you say, Lord, let me do that. Let my family do that. Let my church do that. We want to do what you say. That's what the third petition tells us, okay? So I want you to kind of think about that as we hear the sermon today. And as you do, you're welcome to grab a piece of candy. There's a bowl there and a bowl here. You can take a piece from either bowl. And thanks for being here tonight. Yeah. As the kids are going back to their seats, I invite us to turn in two places. And our scriptures were in the New Testament book of Acts, chapter 21. We're going to read verses 1 through 16 tonight. It's found on page 1031 in our pew Bibles. We're also going to be in our Psalter hymnals, page 921, Lord's Day 49 of the Heidelberg Catechism. As a reminder, we're working towards the edge or the end of the catechism, which is dealing with how we live our lives in gratitude to God for our salvation. And the last section is dealing with living our gratitude through prayer. We often don't think of prayer as an item of gratitude or an action, but in the catechism's understanding, prayer is action, prayer is thanksgiving. And we're now walking through the Lord's Prayer, and this is the third petition. The first petition, hallowed be thy name. We saw how we have to do that with our words and our actions, even in places where hallowing God's name is hard. Last time then we saw the prayer, your kingdom come. We expect God's kingdom to come suddenly and neat and cleanly and visibly as the Old Testament people did. But often God's kingdom comes in our day in messy ways and slow ways through broken people. And that's where we have to have eyes to see his kingdom coming until the trumpet sounds. Now today we move to the third petition, which is more personal. Hallowing God's name happens when his kingdom comes, but his kingdom comes when each of us does God's will in our lives. The kingdom of God happens on an individual level as well as the collective level. And as we deal with that tonight, again, focusing on prayer, I just want to remind us one of my hopes through this extended series on prayer that we've been in all last summer and now it's still today is that God will stir in us as a church a desire to pray. And maybe a tangible way that can happen is I would love to see a prayer team, men and women who have a heart for prayer, who've had that placed in their hearts, who say, we want to be a team. If God's Spirit doesn't call you to that, maybe peer pressure will. Faith has a prayer team, and so does First Series, and we can't let them be better than us. But we want to pray as a group. And we have an opportunity next month to pray in Sioux Falls outside an abortion clinic. We have permission of council to even do prayer after services for anyone who wants prayer. But again, we need people who are willing to do that prayer. So if you have that on your heart, please approach me or an elder in the coming days and let's see what God is up to. And with that before us, we're going to turn to read Lord's Day 49, learning about this part of prayer. I'm going to read the question and invite you to read the answer again of Lord's Day 49. So brothers and sisters, the question is, what does the third request mean? Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven means, help us and all people to reject our own wills and to obey your will without any backtalk. Your will alone is good. Help us one and all to carry out the work we are called to as willingly and faithfully as the angels in heaven. With that teaching of the church about the third petition, we turn to God's word. Before we do, would you pray with me? Our Father who is in heaven, we come to you tonight. And we again acknowledge our brokenness, how easy it is to speak about knowing your will and yet how hard it is not only to discern your will at times, but more importantly, to do the will that we've already know. So Lord, we come to you as sinners needing again the grace of Jesus and sinners redeemed by the blood of Christ, needing your Spirit to guide us in new ways. So may you speak to us through your word tonight and lead us in your way in the week ahead. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Acts chapter 21, this is joining the missionary journeys of Paul at the end of his third journey. After we had torn ourselves away from them, we put out to sea and sailed straight to Kos. The next day we went to Rhodes and from there to Patara. We found a ship crossing over to Phoenicia, went on board and set sail. After sighting Cyprus and passing to the south of it, we sailed on to Syria. We landed at Tyre, where our ship was to unload its cargo. Finding the disciples there, we stayed with them 7 days. Through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. But when our time was up, we left and continued on our way. All the disciples and their wives and children accompanied us out of the city. And there on the beach, we knelt to pray. After saying goodbye to each other, we went aboard the ship and they returned home. We continued our voyage from Tyre and landed at Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and stayed with them for a day. Leaving the next day, we reached Caesarea and stayed in the house of Philip the Evangelist, one of the seven. He had 4 unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. After we had been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt, tied his own hands and feet with it, and said, "The Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles." When we heard this, we and the people there pleaded with Paul not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, "Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up and said, "The Lord's will be done." After this, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea accompanied us and brought us to the home of Mason, where we were to stay. He was a man from Cyprus and one of the early disciples. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, I think we all know what the third petition of the Lord's Prayer is. My question tonight is, how do we say that third petition? How do we say it? I ask that because as you look at language, and I've shared this before, only 7% of communication is what we say. 38% is how we say it, our tone, and 55% is our nonverbals. So something can mean something completely different depending on how we say it. So when we say, "Your will be done," how are we meant to say that? Are we meant to say that with an exclamation point? "Your will be done, sir, yes, sir, whatever you say, sir." Is that what it's meant to be said? Is it meant to be said like a private to a general, "Yes, sir, your will be done," right on top of it? Is that how, with an exclamation point? Or is it said with a question mark? "Your will be done? Is this the will? Is that the will? What is the will? I don't know. We're listening, Lord. What is your will?" Is it a question mark statement? Or is it said with a sigh and embracing ourselves? "Your will be done." Exclamation point, question mark, sigh. How are we to say the third petition? Tonight I'm going to walk through 3 ways we can pray this. The will of God is mystery. The will of God is misery. The will of God is marvel. A 3-point sermon, and they're all alliterative. If you grew up in the 1950s, this sermon is for you. The will of God is mystery. The will of God is misery. The will of God is marvel. First of all, the will of God is mystery. To situate ourselves in the book of Acts, at the end of chapter 20 is really the completion of Paul's missionary journeys. He has finished up his third missionary journey. The people there at Miletus are weeping with him. They don't think they're ever going to see him again. He leaves them behind. He leaves his missionary journeys behind. And he turns his face, as Jesus does, towards Jerusalem. And so we pick up then in chapter 21 with a travel narrative. Notice the first 4 verses. Lots of place names. After we had torn ourselves away from them, we put out to sea. We sailed to Kos. The next day to Rhodes. That was the place of one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world, years before. From there to Patara, we found a ship crossing to Phoenicia, past the south of Cyrus, we landed in Syria, to Tyre, etc., etc. Now, reading this part of Scripture doesn't sound particularly holy. It's a lot like someone saying, and so we left Sioux Center, taking my Buick, we drove through Rock Valley, we went to Sioux Falls, there we went on a plane and we flew to Minneapolis, then we got on a bigger plane and we flew over the Atlantic Ocean, we landed in London, and then we took a train to Oxford. It's not a lot of spirituality, but maybe putting on a map will help us see what he was doing. So he was doing a missionary journey in Greece and then in Asia Minor. They left Miletus and they sailed, hugging the coast to Kos, and then hugging the coast again to Rhodes, and then hugging the coast to Patara. So they're taking small ships. Think of those tiny little planes when you fly to Sioux Falls that they put you in. Anyone like me, that those are terrible. But then in Patara, he could have gotten more small ships and continued to hug the coast, but they got in one of the really big ones and they headed out into the blue water, sailing straight to the land of Israel. And the only land they would have seen between there and their arrival is they saw Cyprus as they passed to the south of us. This is a description of a travel journey, very realistic. You kind of see how Paul had to navigate his way in the ancient world. Now what we see going on here is a tension. When Paul traveled, we know he didn't travel at the seat of his pants. He didn't just travel by happenstance. We know that because in his second missionary journey, he went to a church in Corinth, and then he wrote them a letter describing how he was going to visit them and how he planned his travel. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 describes that. Paul says, I plan to visit you on my way to Macedonia and to come back to you from Macedonia, and then to have you send me on my way to Judea, that's where Jerusalem is. When I plan this, did I do it lightly or do I make my plans in a worldly manner? So Paul is saying, when I plan, I'm always praying the Lord's will be done. I want to follow God's roadmap. I plan in obedience to God's will. And yet the tension is, as we see that travel actually unfold, his travel is dependent on the blowing of the wind and the weather and the presence of ships at port and what ships are there and what ships have tickets and which ones they can get on. And all the way through Acts, we see that he plans, but God disposes. That you seek God's will, but when you actually live it, it's messy. Often God's will is mysterious. It's secretive. It seems haphazard on our end. That's why when we think about the third petition, praying your will be done, theologians remind us that there are two wills of God. One of them is revealed and one of them is secret. So for example, Deuteronomy 22, the Old Testament, we read, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our children, that we may follow the words of his law. There's a will we know of, and there's a will we don't know of. In the New Testament, in Romans chapter 11, who has known the mind of the Lord or who has been his counselor? God's mind, God's will, who even knows that? Question mark, not exclamation point. That's the tension. Hidden will, revealed will. Hidden will is what God intends to do and no one but him knows. Revealed will, what God commands us to do, and that's what we ought to do. Now, when we think about how we pray the third petition, many of us at times might think what we're praying about is God's hidden will. With a question mark, we're saying, Lord, what's your will? Whatever it is, may you do it and show us what it is. Tell us what it is. A commentator that I read on this third petition gave a set of seven steps for determining what God's will is, because in his reading, when we pray, your will be done, we're saying, Lord, help us discern what that is. Help us to know your will. I remember when I was a young man today, I taught my first senior catechism class of the year. And I shared with them that for me, most of my important decisions are behind me. I just live with the consequences. Their important decisions are ahead of them. Do they go to college? If so, which college? If they work, where do they work? What should they study? Should they get married? Who should they marry? All of those big questions. And when I prayed the Lord's Prayer as a high school senior, that was my prayer. Lord, show me, what is your will? I want to do it. Your will be done, but open the right doors, close the wrong doors, speak to me, reveal to me, bring a really cute girl to me. Show your will. But maybe that's not what the third petition is. Maybe that's not how we pray it. We don't pray it with a question mark. Former editor of the Bander, Andrew Kuyvenhoven, says this. Your will be done in the context of the Lord's Prayer refers not to what God has decided to do, his hidden will, but to what he has told us to do, his revealed command. We are not saying in the Lord's Prayer that we bow to God's decision, but we are pledging that we will do what he wants us to do. Notice what the Heidelberg Catechism actually says. And it's not about discovering a mystery, it's about obeying commands. It says, help us to reject our own will and to obey your will. Help us one and all to carry out the work we are called to. The way we pray the second commandment is not with a question mark, but with an exclamation point. Again, to quote Kuyvenhoven, it is a classic misunderstanding that by saying your will be done, Christians bow passively and reverently to the will of God. Your will be done must not be prayed with a sigh of resignation, but as a prayer for personal and universal obedience. It's not a prayer for God to ordain things, it's a prayer for us to obey. It's not a prayer of discernment, it's a prayer of dedication. Lord, Anna says, whatever you do, we will do. Yes, sir, thank you, sir. Praying the will of God is mystery, no, as obedience. How about the second point? Praying not as mystery, but as misery. If the will of God is obedience, I have a feeling that some of us have a sinking suspicion, whatever that obedience is, it's not going to be fun. And as we read Acts chapter 21, there is a shadow of suffering all through what we read. There is the drumbeat of doom all the way through the journey. And so we see Paul right away encounters believers, and through the Spirit, so this isn't just their opinion, they urge Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. That's dangerous. Don't even go there. And then he goes to another port, and someone else comes to him. Agabus, who years before predicted correctly a famine, so he's got a track record of hearing from God. Agabus comes down, and coming to them, he takes Paul's belt, he ties it around his hands and his feet, and he says, again, the Holy Spirit, this is God speaking, says, in this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of the belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. This is a promise of misery. In fact, if you look at this text, this is a sign of a very poignant moment. A couple of verses later, we have this very human scene in Paul's life. When we heard this, we and the people, this is Luke writing, we and the people pleaded with Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. Paul answered, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die. And then notice what they say. When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up and we said, what? The Lord's will be done. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We gave up. Bracing themselves for misery. And actually, this phrase mimics exactly how Jesus used it earlier in Luke in the Garden of Gethsemane. Scholars call Luke, Acts 21, Paul's Gethsemane. Jesus did the same kind of thing. Jesus knelt down and prayed, facing the cross. Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, but not my will, but yours be done. And of course, God's will was suffering in the cross for Jesus and suffering in the death for Paul. And I have a feeling we have that sinking feeling when we pray the third petition. We're to pray it with that bracing sense of something good isn't coming. To show that, if you and I were told that there is, in fact, no God, there's no heaven or hell, there's no consequences for life, we get to do whatever we want, there's no obedience, whatever you desire, that's what you should do, what would your will for your own life be? Anyone? Thinking as North Americans, our will would probably be, if there's nothing else to this world besides what we have, we'd probably like to make a lot of money. Can I get an amen? We'd probably like to have a fairly decent home. Not just one of those shabby ones in the golf course, but I mean a really nice home. Maybe a couple of them, and we'd probably like to have maybe a nice boat so that we can enjoy with our families because we can do it on Sundays now. Right? This would be our will. If we're to have our will be done on earth, this is probably what it would look like. But when we pray God's will be done, what are we envisioning then? Well, probably living in a hut as a missionary. And probably living like a monk with a really funky hairstyle. And probably if we get a boat, it's going to be a junky rowboat. Right? Because God's will is probably not what we would want for ourselves. And that's reflected in how we pray. How often in Sioux County do we pray, Lord, please heal my grandma of cancer. Yet not what I will, but your will be done. And God's will is not healing, it's the suffering of watching someone die of cancer. That's what God's will is. That so often we pray God's will, the third petition, not as mystery, but as misery. This week I heard an interview, a live interview with a pastor. He was a pastor for 25 years. When he was 47 years old, he was fit. He could bench with his son over 200 pounds. I thought, I'd be ashamed to share that out. That's way too little. But he could do 200 pounds. He would run marathons. But one day, he went from being able to run marathons to not being able to drive a car. They put him into the hospital. He continued to deteriorate. He was in a coma for 5 days. He was in the hospital for 77. Went to tests in all the major hospitals. No one could determine what was wrong with him. When he went home, he couldn't swallow for over a year. And during the midst of this suffering, 25 years as a pastor, the doctors had no idea what was going on or how to heal him. And he was okay because he knew he was in God's hands and that God's will would be done. So he had great peace in the hospital. But then when he went home, he had to give up his church because he could barely speak and he was so weak and his mind was confused. And he who could bench 200 pounds was now doing physical therapy with a 1-pound dumbbell. And he called his son who was at college and he talked for 15 minutes. And then his son said to him, Dad, I'm going to hang up. I haven't understood a word you've said in this phone call. And he hung up and this pastor took his phone and began to beat his Bible with it. And say, Lord, you've taken away my job and my calling and my ministry and my ability to talk to my own son. You've taken away everything from me. Your will be done? Not mystery, but misery. And yet that understanding that's reflected in our prayers and at times in our lives is not the way the Bible pictures God's will. Romans 12, verse 2. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. And notice how God's will is described, his good and pleasing and perfect will. God's will is mystery as misery, or maybe as marvel. All the way through Acts chapter 21, people are warning Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. For goodness sakes, don't go there. And yet, every time he gets on a different ship, he continues to head to Jerusalem again and again and again. Why? Why is he doing that? Well, if you have your Bible open, if you look just the next column over in chapter 20, we know why he's doing this. And now, compelled by the Spirit was warning of suffering, but it wasn't telling not to go there because the Spirit told Paul. Remember, he doesn't make his travel by his own or in a worldly way, he obeys. Compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen. Mystery. I only know that in every city the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. Misery. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace. Mystery, yes. Misery, yes. But a bigger story. Paul is able to say, I don't mind if they bind me or if they kill me because I know what I need to do. And what I need to do is to tell people of the good news of a God whose wrath is taken by Christ in an eternity that's open to them. And that is the will of God and nothing else matters. And so he goes to Jerusalem. And if you read on from chapter 21, he speaks of this gospel to the crowd and to the Sanhedrin. And they grab him and they beat him and they put him in jail. And they're going to kill him. But then God opens a door so that a member of Paul's family hears of a plot. And the Roman soldiers protect him. They take him back to Caesarea. And there he shares the good news with Felix and with Festus. And then with Agrippa and Bernice, the most powerful people in the region. And then at Rome's expense, they put him back on a boat. And he retraces his steps and he goes all the way to Rome. And at the end of the book of Acts, this is how it ends. And for 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in Rome, in the center of the empire, in his own rented house, and he welcomed all who came to see him. And boldly and without hindrance, he preached the kingdom of God. Remember, the will of God was to proclaim Christ. And that's exactly what God enabled him to do. Will of God is a mystery, yes, a misery, yes, but it is a marvel because our lives are part of a bigger story. And that the obedience we do and the sufferings we experience are bent by God into a world that's being renewed. Or as a young man named Joseph would say to his brothers in Genesis 50, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended, your will was to harm me, but God intended, God's will, it was for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." That is the marvel of praying the third command, the third petition. Your will be done. May the story that you are writing, Lord, including my life, including my obedience and my suffering, may it be part of that great redemption story. That's how we pray the third petition. So Pastor John beat his Bible with his phone. Couldn't barely speak, couldn't be understood. And yet little by little, through that journey of mystery, what is God doing in misery? Why is he doing it? God shaped John. For 25 years, he preached the gospel. For 25 years, he opened this book just like I do every week. And he read many passages and he believed them. But now they took on new light. And so he read again Isaiah 43, where God says, "You will pass through the waters, but," as we sang our first song, what? "I will be with you." God himself is with us. And that began to shape him in new ways. He writes, he said this in his interview. We just look at it and say, great, God is going to be with us. We'll look at it more closely. His summoning us by name, his redeeming us, not as a guarantee that we'll never have rivers and fires. We will have his protection in the midst of them. We'll have his presence, but we'll go through deep waters and very difficult places as his children. So it's not a pass from suffering or misery. It's a strength to pass through the suffering as a deepened person. He tells about speaking this story and having someone in a wheelchair come up to him and say, what a gift it is that we can suffer. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, use my life. Whether I understand it, whether I like it, use my obedience to move this world and to move me to be more like Christ. That's what he's teaching us when we pray the third petition. Friends, may we pray that petition each day. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we ask that your name would be hallowed, that your kingdom would come. And tonight we ask that that kingdom would come in and through and in spite of each of us, that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven in our lives. As we obey you for what you've commanded us to do, as we trust you in the hidden will that we do not yet know, that we will only discover as you unfold it, that we will see that our lives and our obedience are part of a story that you are in control of, that your will is what will win the day, that nothing can separate us from your love, for you are sovereign. Heavenly Father, may we do your will in this hope, in this confidence, in this trust. For we follow you in the journey of our lives, and all of us pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we pray that third petition, we're asking God to lead us. Our response is, "He leadeth me," and our grace altar hymnals, that is number 452. Let's stand if you're able and sing the four stanzas. "He leadeth me."
Thank you.
Friends, you may be seated. And we do come and trust to the God who leads us, to the God whose will is done on earth as it is in heaven. And we do that as either prayer requests, items to share of joy, celebration tonight, or items of petition. Think about that one shared in the council room. I didn't get the first name of Bauma. I know it's Stephanie Bacom's father. Who? Lauren. Lauren Bauma died. So we want to pray for that family in this day. I believe he had a stroke on Friday, and then died today. So we want to pray for them. Other items of prayer tonight that we can lift to God together. Yeah. Yeah, we're praying for the classes meeting. We'll be getting together. We do twice a year as a region. This time it's in Valentine, South Dakota, which looks to be about a 5-hour one way, so 10 hours on the road, and then a meeting in between. If anyone would like to volunteer, we're leaving at 5 in the morning on Tuesday, so you can come with us. We want to pray for wisdom, for leading, and blessing on that ministry we share. Anything else? I see it. Yeah. Okay, so Kyle's sister had a baby girl, and her name is Emerson Joy. Yeah. So when do you get to see your niece?
Hopefully Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving. Yeah. Oh, we're thankful for that gift of life. Good. Any other prayer requests? If not, let's quiet our hearts and pray together. Heavenly Father, this week we experienced again the power of your creation as storms rumbled through the prairies around our homes and farms, as tornadoes rolled through Sioux Falls. Lord, we were reminded of our dependence on you, that even our strong buildings of steel and glass and wood can be shattered by simply the power of the wind. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we find our refuge this day, not in the stone of this building, not in the name that is behind our first name of our family, not in the bank account that we have, not in the home we live in, but in the fact that we belong to you, the sovereign God, our Father, who loves us and who bends even the winds of this world to your will. Heavenly Father, we would pray today that our lives would not be such that you need to bend them through our disobedience to your purpose, but that you would help us to gladly, willingly, with all that is in us, seek to obey you each day. Lord, this would be a week of, for each of us, greater freedom from sin and greater passion to serve you in our world. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the way tonight we can join the cause of Resonate Global Mission to do that good work of sharing the good news of the gospel, of calling men and women to be disciples, to teach them to obey everything you've commanded, to teach them to obey everything you've commanded, to do your will on earth as it is in heaven, that we can share in that work tonight. Lord, we're thankful for the missionaries who have gone out from this congregation or who we support, those who work with Resonate and those who work with other mission agencies. Lord, we thank you for the reminder for each of us that this work is not just for those who get on boats and get on planes, but that you lead us in the journey that each of us take, even in the neighborhoods and the businesses and the schools that we are part of now. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the meeting of classes that will be on Tuesday. We pray for safe journeys, especially with many road closures and this long journey for many delegates, that you'll help us to make good decisions, that you'll give us unity and wisdom and grace for one another and through us for your world. Heavenly Father, this night we also do pray with Central Reformed just down the road from us as they seek a new pastor after a long pastorate. Lord, may you give them peace and wisdom in the season of vacancy, and may you direct them to the person of your choosing. Gracious God, on this Sunday, we also thank you with our sister congregation, Faith CRC, for 40 years this weekend of worship in you. Lord, we thank you for the work that you've done blessing that church. We thank you for the call they've given now to Pastor Cliff Hookster to join again the staff. And Lord, we just pray that you'll continue to bless that ministry, bless your kingdom's coming. May your will be done in that congregation. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joys that we can celebrate, including the joys of new birth. Thank you with Kyle and his family for a new niece, for Emerson Joy. Father, we pray that this little girl would continue to grow in you, or that she would know about you, that even as Kyle and Alyssa next year move to California, that they could be a part of her life, and that you could use them in the body of Christ to help her know that she is known and to seek to do your will as well. Yeah, Heavenly Father, even as we rejoice with those who rejoice, we mourn tonight with those who mourn. We just lift the family of Lauren Bauma to you. Lord, we ask that you would give peace. Even in this time when we have questions of why, when we miss his presence, Lord, we pray that you would remind each of us that death does not get the final word. That because our sins stain and your wrath has been paid for on the cross, death becomes for us a doorway into your presence and into a new creation that you will give one day, into new bodies and a new beginning. Heavenly Father, may that hope sustain this family even through their tears tonight. Heavenly Father, we lift before you not just these requests we've shared publicly, but the requests that are on our hearts. But we pray that you would work in us, that you would stir in us a deep desire to pray, not just alone, but with one another, that Bethel and the churches of this community would experience a revival of hunger for you, a deep and sensitive experience of your presence among us, and a hunger to share the good news of salvation. Heavenly Father, we pray this all asking that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven, even through us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Today our bulletin covers speak a little bit of the work of Resonate Global Mission, and we give our offerings now for that ministry.
I'm so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear, so I follow through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't want to think, I may never understand, that my broken heart was a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I get is hurt and these four words. So, thy will be done, thy will be done, thy will be done. And I know you're good, this don't feel good right now. And I know you think of things I could never think about. It's hard to count it all joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God and I am not. So, thy will be done, thy will be done, thy will be done. Like a child on my knees, all that comes to me is thy will be done, thy will be done, thy will. I know you see me, I know. Your plans are for me. Goodness you have in store. I know you see me. I know you hear me, Lord. Your plans are for me. Goodness you have in store. So, thy will be done, thy will. Child on my knees, all that comes to me is thy will be done, thy will be done, thy will be done. I know you hear me, I know you see.
Friends, we give voice to that will that God has revealed to us, his plan for this world, the story that we're a part of, and then the testimony our world belongs to God. We'll use that as a profession of faith tonight. So if you're able, I invite you to stand, and we'll say together the words of our world belongs to God, paragraph 44, on page 10 and 33 in your grace altars. Let us profess, following the apostles, the church is sent with the gospel of the kingdom, to make disciples of all nations, to feed the hungry, and to proclaim the assurance that in the name of Christ there is forgiveness of sin and new life for all who repent and believe, to tell the news that our world belongs to God. In a world estranged from God, where millions face confusing choices, this mission is central to our being, for we announce the one name that saves. We repent of leaving this work to a few. We pray for brothers and sisters who suffer for the faith, and we rejoice that the Spirit is waking us to see our mission in God's world. And with that mission before us this week, our closing song, number 548, When We Walk With the Lord. We'll sing stanza 1 and 2, we'll receive God's blessing, and then sing stanza 3. Reminder, after the service, there's prayer time for some of our care and concern groups. If you're a guest with us, we pray you can also stay and enjoy fellowship. Go into this week now with God's blessing from 2 Thessalonians. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, may he encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Go in peace to love, obey, and serve the Lord. Amen. Thank you.